In this video, we will be analyzing different collection methods from teams that have done well in the past. We will be highlighting different types of collectors, wide collectors, collecting from corners, combining collecting and scoring mechanisms, and moving debris inside the robot. This robot uses two vertical wheels in order to suck the cubes into a set position. In order to maintain the position of the cubes inside the robot, they use a small roller. This design is great for when the cubes are all packed in a small space since the collection area is the size of only one cube. Similar to the last robot, this one has a small intake in the front but uses foam conveyors instead of wheels. Like the last robot, it has a small collection width but also feeds the cubes in a single motion. This system is also prone to jamming, shown here. Unlike other systems that have an active collection method, this one has a scoop that pushes into the cubes. The benefits to this design are simplicity and no motors are needed. The downsides are that, once again, it requires the cubes to be in a set place so that active collection is not needed. Instead of collecting the cubes in a scoop or wheel system, this design picks up the blocks like a hand. This system lets the cubes be controlled throughout the robot but requires a lot of accuracy. To collect balls quickly, this team uses a foam roller that squishes over the balls to grip and roll them into the robot. It also uses small mechanism wheels on the corners of the roller, which pulls the balls in towards the middle for feeding. This widens their collector. This design is good for driving over balls, but does not reach out to grab them. Instead of using a foam roller for driving over the balls, this design uses a rubber band style collector that is much more space efficient than a roller because of the flexible properties of the roller. This robot uses a common style of collector that has noodles that stick out of a horizontal roller, which reach out and grab objects. The major downside to this design is the lack of feeding and size of the collector. The upsides are the ease of collection for the drivers and the speed of pickup. By flicking cubes up a central shaft, this system flicks the cubes up into the hopper. The main issue with this system is that the cubes can sometimes get stuck in one of the rollers. When this system works, it is incredibly fast and efficient. Unlike the previous design, this roller has softer noodles which push the ball through the robot smoothly. This system is slightly slower but has more control over the balls. Other teams use small triangles on the sides of their collector to push the balls towards the middle. This team uses PVC pipe as rollers mounted between two channels that run the height of the robot. Much like the robot before, this team has the same style of vertical channels, but they push them beyond the wheels to make the collection wider. The two robots close to the camera are also examples of wide collectors. By pushing the intake outside of the robot, this team was able to get balls in corners. The only issue is that this system requires the robot to sway around to collect in a large area.
Teams like Gluten-Free, the white robot, use longer noodles to reach particles in the corner. In contrast, other teams like Brainstem, the black robot, have collectors that stick outside of the robot's wheelbase to reach corners.
It is also possible to use spinners on the side of the robot to push the balls into the path of the main collector. Unfortunately, these propellers can also get in the way of the normal robot use by flinging balls away from the robot at times. By using a wider collector, teams can also come in from the side to collect balls in the corners, but can't come from straight on. In order to have a more compact and simple scoring mechanism, the collection and drop-off mechanisms can be combined like what Cubix and Hotwire did during Block Party. When it comes to controlling objects inside the robot, there are two methods. One is having a precise collector so that the objects are very controlled. Another is using a more brute force style that collects objects randomly and then does a sort of sorting within the robot. The upside to the more accurate collection is ease of transporting objects inside the robot, but it often leads to a slower collection method. The downside to having more random collection is you need a separate method of sorting objects once inside the robot. A good example of a separate sorting system is the vertical roller system on Vulcan Robotics Rescue Robot. By funneling the sides of their collector, they were able to manage the cubes in a single position with fast collection. There are many mechanisms to move debris in the robot, but the most common and simplest solution is using a gravity-fed system. The main downside to this system is that once the object is falling on its path, you cannot take it back out without ejecting it from the robot entirely. Other options include using rollers or conveyor belts to move objects around the robot. The main downside to this method is the need for a motor and added complexity.
We hope these examples have been helpful in determining what collection system you want for your robot. Thank you for watching.